This video available online for folks to watch. And okay. So, Sandhya, do you want to say anything else? Here, I'll give you the mic.
Hi, good evening, everyone. Thank you all so much for coming. Before anything, I would like to thank Rishi. Let's give him a round of applause for all the seminar we all like for our Saratoga community. I just want to say that I was a few years ago in that audience and anxiously looking at some of the panelists here and trying to listen to everything. All I can say, my kids graduated from Saratoga High. They went to Redwood, Argonaut, Saratoga High, UCLA, Columbia, London School of Economics, and right now they're in New York working, and they're in a different phase of our life where they're looking for rooms and not for colleges. I just want to, it's an honor, I wanted to introduce one person here who really helped my daughter when she was in high school. She was not a 4.0. And with help from people like Mrs. Karen Hyde, I don't know how many of you know her, she was the former vice principal of Saratoga High. And she was one of the main instrumental people in helping my daughter get into college. Right now, I used to work in the career center at Saratoga High for 9 years as a volunteer parent, and that's how I got interested in college admissions. And now working for Flex College Prep, I'm the director of marketing for California. For Flex, but all I can say is there is a college for everyone. So don't worry, it doesn't have to be Stanford, Yale, Harvard, or even UC Berkeley, UCLA. There are lots of private colleges that you can choose from throughout the United States. Think of those options and don't be stuck on getting them into Berkeley or Stanford or Harvard. That's my 2 cents advice. And hopefully you'll get something out of today's seminar, and I thank Rishi once again.
I think that was the final message. It's time to go home now. Thank you, Sandhya. Sandhya is truly the role model. You know, we look at her kids, we look at what she has done, and our kids just try to exemplify and follow the path of what was said by Sandhya and her kids. So Sandhya has really been very helpful to us as well, so thank you. So we'll get started with the presentation. So here is the format for today. What we'll do is we'll run through 10-minute presentations each. And as we are running through the presentations, we'll have Vidushi. Where's Vidushi? Okay, there's Vidushi. Wave your hand, yes, thank you. And Vidushi is gonna be walking around with a pack of cards, with pens. So as you have questions, please jot them down. And then after that, Vidushi, and give it back to Vidushi. And she will bring it over, and then we'll run through a Q&A once we are all done. So we'll run through the first hour of presentations, and hopefully I have all your presentations. If not, I would love to take that on a USB key and have it set up. And so we'll, until 4:30, and then after that, it'll be Q&A. And finally, we'll have a 3-minute wrap-up presentation by each of our panelists. And I know Anjali has to catch a flight, so we'll have Tiffany, the replacer of the panel. Tiffany is heading down, so it's like a tag team here. So let's get that going. What I'll do is I'll introduce our panelists and have them go through the pitch. So Anjali Vaswani, a college counselor and college essay specialist at Flex College Prep. And where are your headquarters?
Headquarters are in Los Altos.
Okay, Los Altos, right here. Okay. And she's graduated from UCLA with a degree in World Arts and Cultures, dance, and a minor in education. Wow, lots of things. While at UCLA, she spent 3 years as a Bruin Ambassador in the Office of Undergraduate Admissions. And she's very good at editing and finalizing the UC applications. She's passionate about higher education and believes that every young adult deserves a chance to thrive at the College of Dreams. With that, I'm gonna turn it over to Anjali. You have a mic right there. Let's welcome Anjali.
Hello, everybody. Can you all see me, or should I stand?
Stand, please.
Okay. Hello, everybody. My name is Anjali Vaswani. I am a college counselor at Flex College Prep. I recently graduated from UCLA with, like Rishi said, a major in dance and a minor in education. I spent time there in the undergraduate admissions office, working directly with students in the local high schools to finalize, edit, and kind of walk through the UC application. So I'm very familiar with all of the steps that it takes to complete the application to the best of your ability, and really make sure that you're presenting yourself the best way possible. So today I'm here, it's 10 minutes, lots of information in a very short amount of time. I'd like to get through a lot of different things that will help you kind of approach the application in the best way possible. Can I first get a feel of who I'm presenting to? So we have middle school parents here, too. Can we raise our hands? Okay. How many freshman parents? Okay, couple. Sophomores? Okay, juniors? And my seniors, we're waiting? Nobody? Okay. So hopefully they're at home waiting for their application results. We can get started. So you are all in the perfect place thinking about admissions. The UC application is known to be kind of daunting for some people. They think of it as only statistics-based. I'm here to kind of break down those boundaries and talk to you about what exactly the UC app is looking for. Many of you know the UC schools are becoming some of the best public universities in the United States, especially in California, with UC Berkeley and UCLA leading the top polls. We're always fighting for first and second place as a top public university. So here you can see kind of some of the stats, and oftentimes students and families get a little bit deterred from the schools because they are scary numbers. You can see 4.18 is your average GPA, which means there's several students who are above that 4.18. I'm here to tell you that it's not all about your grades and your test scores. The UC schools are moving more towards a holistic review of their applications, which means that they're considering other factors. And so in the past, it used to be perhaps an 80-20 split percentage of 80% of the application weight was placed on grades and test scores, and 20% on extracurriculars and college essays. Now we're moving more towards a 70-30, or even at some schools like the top tier UCLA and UC Berkeley, 70-30 or 60-40. My math skills, obviously I was a dance major. We're moving more towards a holistic review, which means we're considering the essay as a very, very strong part of the application, as well as your extracurricular activities and kind of your entire intellectual vitality. Do you love learning? For the sake of learning.
Can I ask a question? Sorry, quick clarification. Are those weighted GPAs or unweighted GPAs?
I have a suggestion. Let's hold off on the questions. We'll give you a name card, card, and just capture your questions on it. That way we can get through the presentation. Otherwise, we'll never get through it.
Thank you. There's only 10 minutes, so we'll get back to your questions later. Moving forward. As you can see, there's a minimum requirement of 3.0 weighted unweighted GPA, SAT reasoning or ACT with writing exam by December of your senior year, and completion of 15 college prep courses, A through G courses. I'm sure several of you are familiar with this material. Now, I'd like to point out these are minimum requirements. So if you reflect back to the slide before, you can see that several of the universities are way above this for GPA, for test scores, and for taking the amount of courses that you required courses, so you want to be going above and beyond these numbers. These are just minimum requirements.
And just a short note on that, if you're writing a question and if you are directing it to a specific presenter, then please put the name there as well. That would be very helpful.
All right, so what exactly are the UCs looking for? There are several different things. Very important is becoming the rigor of your coursework. So even more so than just the courses that you're signing up for, are you taking the most challenging courses offered to you at your school? So how many of your students, or students can speak for themselves, how many of your high schools offer AP and honors courses? Pretty much everybody should be raising their hand, right? I know high schools in this area, Silicon Valley, are extremely competitive, offering the best courses. So just to stand out within your area, that's one of the most competitive in the entire United States, you need to be taking the most challenging coursework possible. Another very important aspect that is becoming even more weighted is the essay. The essay is your opportunity to showcase your personality, give the application a little bit of color and vibrance. Instead of just having great test scores and great GPA, you want to show them who you are, right, on the application, and your essay is the opportunity to do that. The UCs, unlike private universities, don't offer interviews. 120,000 interviews would be a lot, right? So instead, your essay is your opportunity to showcase who you are. It's becoming very important because the UCs are looking for diverse, well-rounded candidates to bring into their schools. State residency is very important. California residents have an allotted amount of applications that are received each year, so you as a California resident have a guaranteed spot, not guaranteed spot, but one of the allotted spots. So let's say out of the 5,000 undergraduate freshman applicants that UCLA took, 4,000 of those will be California residents, approximately. GPA is of course important. It is one of the things that UCs look at and use kind of as a leader. So your, like we like to say, it reflects your test scores and your grades are your foot in the door to these schools. Then once your foot is in the door, you have to showcase all of the other awesome talents about you and awesome qualities to get yourself all the way into the school. Other things that are very important as well, test scores, extracurricular activities, special talents that you may have, characters, and all of your other extracurricular activities that kind of round you out as a person. These are just kind of, if we were to state exactly 14 points that the UCs are looking for, these are them listed out. I'm not going to list them all out. But if you are an applicant who's paying attention to all of these 14 points, you have a much better chance of becoming a strong applicant rather than somebody who's just focusing on, let's say, two or three of these points. Moving forward. So, I mean, we just kind of talked about the importance of extracurricular activities. What does a good extracurricular activity look like? Something that you're passionate about. And now passion is a very large word, it's very broad. So I like to say, focus on what your interests are. If you're interested in math, see if you can join a math club and compete at a regional or national level. If you're interested in badminton, see if you can kind of dabble in badminton a little bit. Follow where your interests lie. And for high school students, it's a lot easier than kind of approaching what your passions are. For me, I was a dancer from the age of 4 all the way up. And so that was my passion, and I was able to kind of focus on that. But I had to remind myself through high school that there are other things that I may be interested in. So I followed my interest in psychology. I followed my interest in sciences. And that kind of made me a more well-rounded candidate for UCLA and for the UC application. Major related activities. So if you have an idea of what you may want to study, start in high school early on focusing on that area. If you know you may want to be a bio major, find bio-related activities that you can get involved in and showcase those activities as something that you're becoming a leader in. And you're kind of taking initiative to really prove that you're a strong bio candidate. Leadership involvement, like I said, leadership comes in many different forms. Starting a club is not the only way to prove that you're a leader. You can also, volunteer or show compassion to other people. Raise your hand in class. I mean, I don't know about, there's several parents here, but I don't know how many of you think that your student is really involved in class. Those students who raise their hands and raise their voice in class and make themselves heard are going to be our future leaders, right? Because they're not afraid to stand up and talk about really interesting material that we're talking about in class. Sustained participation. It's always better to have an activity that you've been doing for several years rather than 20 activities that you've done for 2 days each year, right? I'd rather have a few dedicated activities rather than a laundry list of all the things I've possibly done because I'm not really comfortable with a specific thing. So encourage your students to find their one passion or their one interest and follow that interest in depth. The the UC personal statement, like I said, the essay is becoming even more important. So the essay is something that students should be focusing on from an early start. It's important to kind of discover and develop all the different personal characteristics. This is your chance to show that you have time management skills, but you're responsible, you're compassionate, you're involved in your community. And hearing those words through your own voice is something that the UC application really, really values. This is an opportunity to gain insight into your academic and personal extracurricular achievement. So if you have something that really stands out on your application and didn't have a chance to explain it, this is the place to do it. This provides the admissions readers, like I said, with an in-depth view of who you are as a person. Two don'ts for the UC personal statement. These are very important. Don't write an essay that everybody else could have written. So we hear all the time about, or admissions readers get the essay, oh, my coach is really awesome. He led us to the championship game and I kicked the winning goal and it was the best experience of my life. Anybody could have written this essay. So what makes you different? Even if this was your experience, how can you kind of maybe bring it back to an academic achievement or tie it into another aspect of your life so you're interweaving multiple different connections and showcasing yourself as a complex individual. Don't focus the majority of your essay on your parents' background. So that goes back to, you know, a lot of our Indian, I know you guys are looking at me like, who's this white girl with the Indian name? I'm Anjali and my dad was Indian, so I'm very familiar with having a tiger Indian dad pushing all straight A's, you know, so I get that, but talking about that experience is going to be very similar for all the other Indian kids, right? So find something that makes you unique. We are in an area where we have, you know, the most Asian American families who are really strong in grades and test scores. So how can you stand out in other areas that really make you kind of more diverse? You can, there's an additional comment section on the UC application. This is interesting to point out, we just kind of, the UC's just extended that and gave you a little bit more space to talk about things that are very important to you. So this is a place that you can list any additional honors and awards that you may have. That you don't have space for in the actual designated honors and awards section. You can discuss concerns regarding an illness that you may have had or a specific obstacle that caused you to not get the best grade in a certain class or drop out of high school for perhaps a semester and then come back in. This is your place to explain that. I would encourage you to use this space to concisely explain those obstacles that you may have faced, and then if there's something that has really shaped who you are as an individual, for example, when I was applying to school, my mom had breast cancer. So this was something that really shaped my application. I dealt with several different kind of challenges that came along with that during the same time that I was applying, so I used that in my essay to write about it. It wasn't necessarily to use it as a sob story, but it was used to use it as a showcase of my ability to overcome challenges and approach different problems through problem solving and critical thinking. So that's kind of, those are the kinds of things that you can use in the actual essay. The additional comment section is not an extra essay. So it's just a place to kind of put extra information that you want to get in on your application that you think is important. Which campuses should you apply to? So we have, how many, do we all know how many UC campuses there are? Shout it out if you know the answer. 9, yes, got it. Okay, so we have 9 UC campuses and each campus provides its own kind of unique environment, different kinds of professors, different kinds of classes and clubs and activities that you can be involved in. So make sure you're doing your research. Families can help with this. Parents, help your students find out which UC campus may be the best fit for them. Not everybody wants to go to UC Berkeley or will feel comfortable at UC Berkeley. I have a little story before I run out of time. When I went to, my parents were really, really gracious and brought me on huge California college college trip where we went to tour all these different universities. So I went to UC Berkeley and thinking, you know, UC Berkeley is amazing, I want to go to UC Berkeley. And it was pouring rain, freezing cold, all the kids were walking around with hoodies in their backpacks, like super upset and angry about going to class. And I just saw myself not living there and being happy. I didn't see myself fitting into that campus. Then I traveled down to UCLA. It was bright and sunny and the kids were laughing and excited about going to class. Like, I can see myself here. I can be at this school. So that was kind of how I shaped my dream to go to UCLA. If you can help your students do that and achieve that kind of goal where they can see themselves living there, it's going to be home for 4 years, right? I know mom and dad want to keep your kids at home, but they should go and explore university. And so give them the opportunity to research the school in depth and find the place that fits them socially, culturally, and geographically. All right. So last slide, what can you do now to become a competitive applicant? We have several middle school parents and you know underclassmen in high school. The most important factors are get involved. If you're not involved in what you're interested in right now, this is the first thing you have to do. Find activities that you're interested in, get involved in them. Even if you're just a participant now, later on you can take those steps to becoming a leader in those activities. Take your experiences to the highest level you can. If you're already a participant, like I said, take the next step. How can you push yourself and challenge yourself? Parents, continue challenging your students, or your kids, they're not your students. UC's value students who are valued in their community. So we're in Saratoga, Zambia told me it's a small community. So how can you get involved and help out those people around you that you consider, you know, your neighbors and your family? Seek out challenges that you may not have access to at your school. So not all schools have a robotics team. Not all schools, well, maybe all schools in Silicon Valley have a robotics team, but not all schools have, you know, the specific interests that your student may be interested in. Find outside avenues to approach those interests. And tie your extracurricular activities to academic ones. So maybe, you know, basket weaving somehow ties back to math, which probably does. But, you know, find those ties and make sure that you're kind of showcasing them on the application. So this is my 10 minutes. I know I probably went over, but I thank you for letting me speak today. And Tiffany Liu will be here later to answer a lot of questions and give a little bit of a presentation as well. So thank you.
Thank you, Anjali, coming in all the way from LA. So thank you for joining us. And a couple quick notes here. One is, you know, you don't have to take pictures. We'll be uploading the slide deck to SlideShare. And then as long as you put down your email, there's a little a notepad coming through. So just sign up with your email and we'll send you the slide deck and also the video. The videos will be posted online so you can share with your friends as well. And with that, I'm going to turn it over to Karen Hyde. Karen Hyde, as we know, is a former science teacher right behind me. She's fast. And so lifetime educator and a champion of teenagers. And she began as a science teacher, became a dean and vice principal, serving for decades at Saratoga High School. And back in 2012, so about 4 years ago, she opened a college admissions counseling business in Los Gatos and loves working with teens. And she begins working with students as freshmen and supports them and their families through the convoluted, ever-changing process of college admissions. And her business supports all students, athletes, those with IEPs or 504s, I don't know what that is, maybe high achievers and those seeking a college that will develop a path towards success. So let's all welcome Karen.
Good afternoon, thank you. This is impressive, if nothing else. When she asked me to come, I said, sure, happy to do this. Love Saratoga, was there for too many decades. And then he said, but you need a picture. I don't have one. It was, and then you have to do something on a PowerPoint. I don't have time. So one of my students lovingly put together my PowerPoint and said, just stand in front of it and point. So if you see me running to the side, it's because Andrew, excuse me, did this for me. And thank you, Sonia, that was very, very nice. And if Sonia was really honest, she would say that her students taught me. So when she said, what would you like to speak about? I said, throw me in anywhere. I mean, it's uncomfortable with, we all are with that which is involved in the college process. But I think all of us would share with you the same thing. Even if you had a student who graduated 3 years ago from high school and now is in college, the process today is very, very different than the process that occurred 3 years ago, 4 years ago, certainly 10 years ago. It's a light year different. And what I have found is, having worked with students for decades, is that it isn't just the students that have changed, but the parents that have changed, and the college is expecting more. So in my office, I have a sign that says, it's not where you start, it's where you finish. And I really believe that. There is college for everyone. And Brian Safin from Saratoga High School did this wonderful presentation last year that showed the number of students who got into UCLA. And I want to say, I went to Davis, so we're all from the UCs. We will do fight songs later for you. And I didn't go because it was nice weather, and it certainly wasn't because of the cows. So Davis was a great place to be, and I thoroughly enjoyed it. We'll talk about that later. But college is extremely different, and I even had a discussion today with a parent and a student, and I said, we will get you in somewhere, because it's not where you start, it's where you finish. And what you do in college is not dependent on where you went to college. It's what you did there, just as Anjali said. It's the resume that you built. It's the grades that you get. It's the test scores that you achieve and the connections that you make. And I'm talking about college to grad school. So pushing our kids to where they're going to attend, it needs to be, and I, as Rishi said, I start with freshmen, so I meet with my kids for 4 years, and it's the same kids for 4 years. And I say to them, where do you want to go to college? And they go, Harvard, Stanford, Yale, UCLA, UC. And I know, as we all do, that that will not be occurring. So what I try to do with kids, as I'm sure we all do, is develop who they are. What is their voice? How do they get to achieve what they are actually capable of achieving, not just what we as parents demand? I have two children. One is the high achiever, and then I have him. And he taught me humility. He will probably, in all likelihood, be the more successful of the two, albeit she's an attorney. Definitely, he will be more successful than she. But it really wasn't where they went to undergraduate or even graduate school. It's what they bring with them, as Anjali indicated. It's the passion they develop, it's the character that they have. And this is reflected in the resume. Next. So, Andrew put these little, he said, I didn't like what you wrote, so I put in these important missives, but they really are true. Staying focused, following directly from where you start to what you do is critically important. So I have kids who come in from the eighth grade, and they were on 20 clubs, and they are in three sports, and this is what they want to do in college. And naively, they think they can do it. The reality is we know that they can't. So we need to factor in what is your true skill, what is it that your character yearns to develop, more than just what is it that you think will get you into college. 2 weeks ago, and I'm sure because you parents are the kind of folks who are here completely dedicated to your kids and their successes, you saw the Turning the Tide that came out from Harvard. There are now over nearly 100 schools that have committed to doing, changing their perspective of accepting students, not just based on test scores, as Anjali indicated, based on test scores and grades, but on the whole student. So they don't just want to see one thing that they have done annually. They want to see something that they have developed over 4 years. They want to see, even if they brought it from the eighth grade, albeit we can't write it in a resume, and that it started in the eighth grade. Resumes start with freshman year. So I have lots of long faces when I say, hi, freshman, it was really nice that you did 8 years of piano, but we can't put it in. It's like, really? And then the glare is at the mother. The reality is, I come from an Italian family, so it's the mother. So it's more about what they have done in high school and the person they become. That's the critically important thing. Who is it that they started out to be? What courses have we directed them, led them, if you will, to take? And what is, who is the person, the character that they are, that they're becoming? So, next slide. Please, thank you. So I worked, as Rishi said, with students who have were involved in sports. I have probably 30% of my kiddies are athletes, but I also have students who have special needs, IEPs, or those with some challenges, 504s. And everything from soup to nuts can get into a college and a good one. So this is a copy of a resume that has a variety of arenas that is important for students to identify. And I can just run through them. You don't need to see that, because back there, you can't. I didn't expect millions of you. But I do have two samples of two of the kids, and yes, I got permission, so we won't all be sued, to show you what it looks like. A college resume is vastly different from the resume that parents want them to submit. So they don't want to know what are your skills. The fact that you can do Microsoft Word and Excel is irrelevant to the UC admission people, or to a private school admission people. Yale doesn't care. So we need to know about what is it that they're doing in school, their GPA, their test scores, their involvement, their extracurriculars, both in the school and in the community. And they are now, through this turning the tide, that schools that have now submitted, yes sir, we will certainly change the way we look at applicants. And interestingly enough, a woman by the name of Denise Pope signed on to that as well. She is the woman who wrote the, she's a Stanford College of Education professor who wrote Doing School. All these folks are acutely aware of something that we lovingly call Doing School, where they do it because they think the admissions office wants it. The reality is they know what they're looking for. And they don't want to see what some folks say you need to be doing. You need to do robotics for 4 years. Yes, you're going to be a math major, so you need to do it. More importantly, if you're a math major who's in charge of the math leagues or takes AIME, that is really who they should be becoming. So the sports resume indicates their individual sports and, as importantly, community service. So the community service, by the way, also is taking a new tack, as these ladies all know, which is not just that they have done 20 different arenas, but they have done a few with dedication, and they are also looking for connection with the family, and that's the first time I've seen that in 40 years, that they are looking for, if you are helping grandma out, we now will put that in the resume. That's new to anything I've ever written. So yes, students have written essays about it, because as I say to all of my kiddies as they're writing their essays, make me laugh, make me cry, touch my heart. So helping grandma as she's going through some difficult times is a great thing to write, but I've never put it in a resume, and that will soon be added. Next slide, please. So this is a resume with leadership. And I have four parents, they're not my four parents, four of my students' parents interviewed. Two for MIT, two for Stanford. And yes, they don't interview locally for Stanford. But these are students who come from out of the area. They have all said the same thing to me independently. We could look at all of our applicants, and they look the same, they talk the same, the GPA is the same, their activities are the same, and then the admissions director say, give us five out of the 25 people they have you've interviewed. And they said, what we can do is pull them out of the hat because they're all the same. So perhaps turning the tide will make a difference. Perhaps indicating more of who they are and what they're doing will make a difference. But as importantly, I think what is missing from many of the kids as I start to work with them and as they approach further in their four-year development, leadership. If there is an opportunity, and you don't need to run for student body president, but if somebody says, hey, we need a secretary in a club, what I say to my kids, I want to see that floating arm. You volunteer, and that's leadership. If you are taking a role at a community service opportunity and somebody says, hey, could somebody make phone calls? I will make those phone calls. So I'm asking my students to develop the floating arm, and that certainly works. All of you people are probably the ones who set up the tables and take down the tables at every community opportunity in which you are active. You are the folks who have learned to have that floating arm. You need to impart that to your students. It's difficult. The stomach sometimes gets upset, but that's the critical part. So, next slide, and I only have a couple more. I promise I'll be on time. This is, notice he goes to Pablo Picasso. The science major is, it would have never been me, Pablo Picasso. Next slide, please. And these will be, or not that. That's a surprise. I like that. We'll keep going. Well, this was one of my students, and he gave me permission. He's a Leland student. His aunt helped him. She's a PR person. Put together his resume, so it looks lovely, but it has every part that I want in there. So it has community service. It has leadership. It has activities, and it has the information about the school. Next one, please. You may all know the Berardo children. So this is Issa Berardo. This is her sports resume. I always ask the students to put in a CLP, a cute little picture. Because if it's used for a resume, and then it's used for an interview at some point, I have had more students who have been able to present their resume with a cute little picture where someone says to them, you played violin, so did I. Or you were on robotics, because it's always something that they have done. It's a conversation starter. So my students put this in arenas where it says additional information. The resume is implanted, certainly in the private schools. Many schools now request it. So on that happy note, I will turn it over to you.
Thank you. Thank you, Karen. Karen is truly an icon for Saratoga, so we're delighted to have you here today.
That means old.
That means all the knowledge that you can grasp. So you got some in 10 minutes, but keep asking questions. On questions, we have a couple of volunteers. Vidushi is back there, so she's got cards for you. If you have questions, please write them down, and she'll bring it over to me, and then we'll run through the Q&A after all the panelists are done. And then you also have, what's your name?
Ankita.
So we have recruited Ankita to walk around in this section, so if you have a question, she's got the cards for you. And what's your name?
Rishal,
yes. So we have three volunteers manning the three aisles for you. And one more thing, I would like to invite, this is a free seminar, and we have to rent the room, so I would like to invite Nish Sthana to come up here and talk about one-to-one app. Come on up here, and turn the mic over. Thank you for your sponsorship, really appreciate it.
Thank you very much, Rishi. First of all, Rishi, thank you very much for inviting us and giving us an opportunity to come here. My name is Nishant, and my co-founder is Abhinav. We are technology startups from Silicon Valley, and we have a few companies that we run. One of our latest products is actually to help high school students get college advice directly from college students. So what we found out that a lot of high school students have a lot of resources available on the internet and these great college counselors. But what was lacking was the real experience that a person in UC Merced or San Jose State or Harvard went through to actually get into that college. And that is something that we thought was missing. And when I was growing up, I did not have an opportunity to come to US when I was growing up. I was in India. But the only reason that I'm here is because of the advice given to me by my seniors who were doing what I wanted to do. So we thought that is something missing in this high school sphere. So we created an app which allows high schoolers and their parents to reach out to college students from across US, as well as outside US if need. Right now, we just launched it 3 weeks back, and we have students, college students, who signed up as mentors from Ivy Leagues and UCs, and every day we are signing up close to 10 to 20 mentors every day. So we wanted to come here and talk to you about this app. This app is called One-on-One. It allows you to have secure private sessions with college students. And all you have to do is go look at their profiles. You can know what school they went to, what high school they went to, what was their SAT score, what ACT, the whole profile. You'll get all the profile. then you can look at when they are available. You just book a call, and it's like Uber, basically. It's like, you know, instead of a taxi, you are actually soliciting advice from a real college students. And all of these college students are verified. We make sure that they are from that particular college. They need to have their IDs and student IDs. And all the payments and the phone calls happen through the app, so none of the personal information is shared. And after the call, you rate the mentors, and the mentors basically rise up and up in the process as more they talk to more and more people. So if you have an iPhone, just type on your app store. It's called 1:1 space peer-to-peer mentoring, and you will see the app. There's only one app there out there, and we are putting up the Android version in the next couple of weeks. We are here, right here. If you want to sign up or for the app, we are giving the first free phone call is free. So if you want to sign up, please reach out to me here. I can sign you up for that. Thank you very much, Rishi, and I hope you know everybody gets an awesome education from this panel today. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Nish. Thank you for your support. And you know, talk about the power of social media. You're trying to put together this event, and then I see a posting from Nish on Facebook. I have no idea how we are connected, but we are connected. Then I see his app rollout, and I said, hey, he's the right guy to sponsor this thing. So that's how it came together. Social media is a good thing. So I'm gonna. I think Bill Gorman's team is also here. Anybody from? Yes, come on up here. And do we have Karishma Chandani? So we have the banners. They support all our events all through the year. So I'll do a little quick pitch about all the events we run. It's thanks to our sponsors. They are our event sponsors for the whole year. And they sponsor everything we run from January all the way through December. And this one is a freebie because it was not on the plan last year. And we are actually doing a drought-tolerant vegetation seminar later on this month. So there are quite a few new events that get added to our calendar. If you would like to see our events calendar, there are two ways you can look at it. One is you can go to my website, rishikumar.com/events, and you will see all the events that we have planned for the rest of the year. And the other way, you know, the alternate way is you can go to tinyurl.com/Saratoga class. And on every Sunday, tomorrow is Super Bowl Sunday, and the 49ers are not there, but so our classes are canceled nevertheless. But the classes we have on Sunday includes the Silicon Valley Coders Club that my son, he was here, he's launched that. And we actually are running it in the city of Saratoga, in the city of San Jose, with the blessings of Mayor Sam Licardo and his team, Ash Kalra, Magdalena Carrasco, council members. So we are running it in a district to provide advantages to kids that may not have those advantages. And then also in Livermore, starting late February. And quite a few other cities are interested as well. And it's completely voluntary driven, it's all offered for free. There's no charge. And the city of San Jose is sponsoring everything that we're doing. In fact, it'll be providing laptops for these kids as well. So Silicon Valley Coders Club, we also run the robotics club, which is the Lego robotics club. Any kid here who's been part of a robotics team? Anybody? Nobody here. Oh, I see, yes. So we have a few kids. You know, when we first started this, we had only a single team in Saratoga. Now with the Lego Robotics Club, we have about 8 to 10 teams that now participate every single year. And along with that, we also have meditation, yoga, Bollywood fitness, all the fun stuff. So with that, Bill Gordon and Monica Goyal. She is here on behalf of Bill Gordon. Thank you, Bill.
Thank you.
Thank you
so much.
Yes.
So, I'm glad he clarified Monica Goyal. I do not look anything like the woman. He's like 6'2 something. So a lot of you actually, I'm glad to see a lot of familiar faces here. Some of you know me as your friends. Some of you have seen me at the open houses, at some of the listings, and I do see a lot of familiar faces. And maybe, and I've told that some of you recognize me by my signature sweater. At the open houses, people look at me and say, ah, I remember you. You wore that last time I saw you. So that helps. That always helps. I am really thankful to be where we live because a couple of weeks ago, I was visiting family in East Coast. and we got hit by the blizzard. And you guys are probably thinking, why was I there? And I was thinking the same thing. But when I was there, every day I thanked my stars, and I was so thankful to be in Silicon Valley, where the weather is wonderful, where our daughters are excelling in science and math, where our daughters participate in Google competitions. Not only they participate in the coding competitions, but they excel and they win them. And our sons, they dream of inventing things when they grow up so they can improve this world. So that's why this is a wonderful place to be. As a real estate consultant in Saratoga, I am thankful for the community to give us this opportunity, because you guys have made our job really easy to work in Saratoga. Saratoga is not only the safest community, safest city in the United States, this is also the schools are excellent. And we all have seen the influx of professionals moving to Silicon Valley in the last few years. We are seeing that a lot of young families want to move to Saratoga area because they find the community to be very safe, they find it's a very family-friendly environment. Most of all, they appreciate the schools, which are excellent, and they know if their kids go through this system, they will do something right and something good in life. For that, I would like to thank the parents, and more so the students who go to these schools and who make it so wonderful that we as realtors do well and we have an easy time doing our business. So thank you for being here for us. I really appreciate it. And I want a round of applause for the kids who go to these schools.
Thank you, Monica, for joining us, and truly appreciative of Monica and Bill Gorman for supporting our community the way they do, because all the good things in our community happens with the support and sponsorship of our community leaders like Bill. So thank you. And Karishma and Deepak Chandani, they are our other event sponsors. They are not here yet, so I will be turning over the mic to them also when they are here. I would like to quickly introduce Marci, Reichelstein. She's the admissions team, Marci. And she's part of the admissions team at Stanford University, Northwestern University, University of Virginia. She's a former lecturer at Stanford University, Critical Analytical Thinking course. And she's got a certification in college admission counseling at UCLA. She attends professional conferences to stay current on trends and institutional policy. And we also have Tiffany Liu, who has joined us. Tiffany, yes. Thank you, Tiffany, for joining us. So Anjali has to catch a flight before all the roads get jammed with the Super Bowl activities. She's running to the airport. And Tiffany, thank you so much, Anjali. A big round of applause for Anjali. Anjali, hopefully we'll have you back next year as well. Okay, fantastic. We timed this with Guidance Night. Saratoga High School had a Guidance Night a couple days back. And so it was actually announced, I think, Brian Safin, and it was announced. Yes, it was announced, and so we'll try to time it with the Guidance Night every year. And a quick introduction of Tiffany. Tiffany will be answering questions. She's the Chief College Counselor at Flex with more than 8 years of experience. She's the World Journal newspaper educational columnist, Westminster Seminary, and Stanford University, and also she's got a BS in biological sciences. Thank you. Thank you, Tiffany, for joining us. And with that, I'm going to turn it over to Namita. And let me just quickly introduce Namita. How can you present without an introduction, right? So her topic is getting great recommendations. Namita is an independent college consultant in the Bay Area. She lives right next door in Cupertino. And she's passionate about making a difference in young people's lives. She's been working with many unprivileged students at college track gain admissions to the best colleges of their choice. She holds an MBA degree in finance, postgraduate certification in college admission, and career planning from UC Berkeley. And prior to college consulting, she worked in the high-tech companies at HP, IBM, former IBM, just like me. And she has watched her students grow and succeed in their college life. She also has a professional membership with WACSC and HECA. With that, then I turn it over to Namita. A big round of applause for Namita.
Part of application process is the recommendation letter. It's like the asphalt on the road, like, you know, you have your grades, you have your extracurricular activities and resume, but we also, the universities want you to be recommended by somebody who knows you as a person, just things which cannot be told by grades and other test scores. So let's move to the next slide. In this, so first I will talk about the recommendation, what's the purpose of it, and the elements of a great letter, who to ask, when to ask, and how should you go about getting a great letter. The reason I came about this topic when Rishi asked me what topic am I going to present, I had just met a student, and I asked him, he's a rising senior, and I asked him, how about the recommendation letter? Do you know who I'm going to ask? And have you thought about it? He said, yeah, I just have to send an email to my tutor and guidance counselor that I will have it. But getting a good recommendation letter, an effective one, requires more work and more time commitment from you. It is just not sending, hey, Mr. So-and-so, can you write me a recommendation letter? No, that won't be the greatest idea. So, next slide. So the purpose of the recommendation letter is to showcase who you are as a person. And it reveals the traits and the qualities which your test scores cannot tell. And it's also by a person who can tell about you, about opinion about you by somebody, and present you in the best light, showcasing your abilities and skills. Next slide. So what is a great letter? Just letter, just a saying that, okay, person such and such is a great student, hardworking, he's responsive, that doesn't really work. You have to, the recommender has to be more specific. It should talk about your skills. You have to skip one. Yeah, it should show the reader. The letter should show the reader that the person writing the letter has known you for some time. It is just not somebody who's become your friend and that wants to write, or your relatives. It has to be a person who knows you very well and provide insight about your personalities and character instead of listing your accomplishments, because your resume is going to give you all your accomplishments and your awards. And analyzes you, it's more analytical, analyzes your character and your personality, and also how you have challenged yourself through all your high school year. And use specific result-oriented, this is very important, use specific result-oriented details to illustrate your, to talk about what the statements was made in the recommendation letter. Next slide. And it talks about the skills that matters in the college. Like organization skill, class participation, what following through the instructions, and how did you react to the adversities. It is not like things which doesn't really relate to the college success, doesn't really matter. If you're a good quarterback, that doesn't really matter how you will succeed in your academic life. Hint at your potential and your future goals. It should. It is important that a good letter should encompass all these little things in a nice, concise manner. And mention your recommendations qualification. Without that, it has kind of not as much of value. Mm-hmm. And state that you would make a great contribution to that particular college or university you go. Every college there, it's just that, just the way you are looking for a good college fit for yourself, the colleges also want a good fit for their campus, a student who will fit and who will contribute. It will be a good asset on the campus. Next slide. So the question is who to ask. from your junior year, not your eighth grade teachers or your freshman teachers. It's like people who have seen you the way you are at the time of application, more like that. So junior year teacher or your current senior year teacher, if it is, person who has known you for some time. And the classes where you have engaged intellectually, not necessarily you have achieved the best grade, but you have challenged yourself, you were motivated in the class, you were participating in the class. And most of the university, like UC Berkeley requires recommendation from science teachers or math teachers. But other universities, like private universities, most of them, they require one recommendation from a math or science teacher and one humanities teacher. So, and other adults, such as your employer, coach, or advisor for your activity, or other adults, it could be, who are excited to write about you, or who can give you the strongest and the most valid account of your accomplishments and your potentials. Next slide. So when do you ask? Do you ask like 2 weeks before your deadline? No. The earlier you ask, the better it is. Most of the teachers write many letters, and a lot of them prefer to work during the summer. And also, just like it's a human tendency, if a teacher has to write, for example, just a number, 30 letters, so by the time, when they're writing first, second, third, their best quality, they can spend more time, they're more energetic. By the time they reach at the 25th, 30th, they won't be their best. That would be kind of running short of time, they would be burnt out. So the sooner you ask, the better it is. So, spring of junior year is a good time to think about and ask some of your teachers if you're planning to apply early actions or early decision. But surely by the beginning of the senior year, for some week of starting your senior year, you must ask them. So give your teachers at least 1 month to write and submit your letter. And let them know the deadlines ahead of time. And it is really important that you need to let them know so that they can pace out themselves. And in my personal experience, I have few students, they just gave their teachers one, like couple of days, and the result was not, of course, very desirable. So it is very important that you give your teachers enough time. So the question is, how do you get a great letter? Do you just say, Mr. So-and-so or Ms. So-and-so, can you write me a letter? But remember that you have only one teacher or two recommendation letter to get, but the teacher has to maybe write, in some of these big schools, maybe write 30 letters or 40 letters. So they are very busy, and also at the same time, every year they are teaching maybe 100 students or 150 students. So they tend to forget. They would know you, but maybe they don't remember what you did exactly. So it's important, as I said in the grade elements, in the elements of the letter, that you have to give specific. So it is, they have to give examples. So it is important that you nudge their memories, remind them about yourself. So maybe give a copy of the project or the paper you wrote for them. If you don't have a copy, maybe give them a detail of your projects and what you wrote about it. And describe them the paper, what you did, and tell them what you learned in the class. That is important too. Next slide. So make them remember you. You remind them of the specific projects you were part of, and tell them about your class participation. Give them any information they need to give more specific example of your work. And you must mention also the other challenges you might have overcome for the past period. Next slide. So, and make sure they remember you. What I mean is, tell them, recommendation letter, it should not be just like an essay, just one blanket, like, you know, of course, there will be some things which will be common, but at the same time, each letter has to be tailored for one specific college to find out, why are you applying? If you are 10 colleges, why are you applying for each? You need to have your own reasons, because they should be a good fit for you. So make clear that your teacher knows why you're applying to each college and how each college meets your objective for your career or meet objective for your learning style or your interests. Make sure that the teacher knows the reason why you're applying. And ask the teachers to give examples of anything else happening in the class, what happened, and more details. And provide a rag sheet, a resume, about showcasing all the things, which are all your qualities and skills and accomplishments which you want to highlight in the letter. So as I mentioned, besides the two teachers' recommendation, one counselor recommendation is required. That's required by every, doesn't matter which school you're applying to, that is required by every school counselor recommendation. And as you know, counselors have a huge counselor, they are very busy, but at the same time, it is recommended that you make an appointment and then ask them and talk to them. And if you have anything more detailed to talk about, like for example, if you want to discuss some lower grade in your sophomore year, maybe it's a good idea to talk to them in person, make an appointment and explain what happened and why you had a difficulty, how you overcome the challenges, and how did you improve. So any kind of things, it's just important to do it in the So at the end, the final tip is make sure your references know your deadline and follow up with your references 1 or 2 weeks before the due date. They get busy. College application is top of your priority, but not for the recommenders. And they are just being nice to do it for you. And once you have decided which college to attend, please write them a note, a thank you note, and let them know. And be polite. Make sure your teachers, your recommenders, and they know that you appreciate their effort. And because it is the way I've described, if you're doing, you can see it's a lot to write in a letter. If they're spending, each letter will take more than 5 minutes or so. It will take a significant time. So, thank you.
Thank you, Namita. And we are on to the home stretch with our presenters. We are running a few minutes late, but we still have 10 minutes for you, Priya. And a quick word about Priya. Priya has been running a free college counseling in Saratoga. And I would say for about a year and a half now, you know. So she basically meets with parents and students on the first Sunday of the month. And that's been ongoing for almost a year and a half, off and on. So she takes the time to be here joining us and meeting the parents. And so it's great to have Priya back and run through a quick introduction. So Priya is a college counselor based in Silicon Valley. She holds a master's degree in economics from the University of Mumbai and a master's degree in counseling psychology from the University of West Alabama. She's worked with both middle and high school students in the capacity of a mental health counselor in a public school. To fulfill a desire in helping students on a more personal level, Priya has pursued the certification program from UC Berkeley in college admissions and advising. So over the last 4 years, she's helped several students with making their college list, completing their college applications, and editing their essays as well. So with that, please welcome Priya.
I'm Priya Pullur. For the last 5 years, I help a number of kids with their college applications, especially their essays. I've been working on essays with them. And today my topic would be options for students with low GPAs. Let me just clear one thing at the very beginning. I'm not advocating for a low GPA. There's no way out of that. You have to maintain that GPA and try to work hard at it. But life happens, stuff happens. Just move on, sorry. And you know, you now, maybe you just, you had a family emergency at home. You know, you spent a lot of time on sports or other events that took you out of the state. Or you know, spent a lot of time on hobbies or anything. Or some, you know, things like that, which just now you are now stuck with a low GPA. This could have happened in your freshman year, sophomore year, or even your junior year. And God forbid if it happens in the senior year, there is no way out of that. You know, I cannot help you with a low GPA in your senior year. So, but once you are at this, what are we going to do? What is a low GPA? I would think anything below 2, you know, your chances are pretty slim. You know, you may get it somewhere, and I'm not saying no, because there is a college out there for everybody. Just as Sandhya mentioned at the very beginning, there is a college out there for everyone. But what do we do? But if, well, let us first try to understand, the UCs need a GPA of 3.5 maybe or more. That's what I would think for now, because things keep changing. And any of the Ivy Leagues, 3.8 or more, that's what we're looking at. So there are a number of good state schools that are looking at, you can still consider and try to work for. What, let's try to understand a little bit more about what are the admissions criteria that the schools are looking at. The number, the first, 1 and 2 would be your GPAs and your test scores, and there is no kidding, you know, those are the things that they're looking at. But now if you didn't have one, what are the other things that we could look at? We start working on 3, 4, 5, and 6, because those are still things that we can control and work on in your senior year and try to get there. So what we you know, what are the kind of extracurricular activities you indulge in? You know, try to get better at them, volunteering, the number of hours that you devote to them. Could we move on to the next slide? And there are a couple of other things that we need to consider too. You can look into colleges that have a different method of looking into it, college admissions. One of them would be Bard, that I can think of right on top of my head. They offer a different, besides the usual regular path of looking into GPAs, your transcript and everything else, they also use a method of using, you know, you need to write 4 essays that are about 2,500 words long, and you get a B plus for 3 of them, you're into Bard. That's all they're looking at. And the essays are usually read by Bard faculty. And this is just one of those things that you could consider if you're not the typical student who you know, excels at and gets those GPAs that are high up there. The other options would be looking into universities that allows a transfer. You get into one of them which has a lower GPA, and then you look to transfer out the next year. One other option to look into would be conditional acceptance programs, where depending on the other characteristics that they have seen on your application, they have liked you, you're a strong candidate, except for the iffy GPA that you have. So what do we do then? They give you this conditional acceptance, provided you keep up a GPA at a certain number, and you go to, you know, through the school year. If you are not able to do that, you're out of there. So this is another, you know, path to consider. Besides that, if this has happened in your sophomore or freshman year, you just you had tough teachers, your grades just dropped, and, you know, there was something that happened. You can try to get a tutor, boost your scores in that particular subject that you know you, that affected you, and try to get out of that problem, move on, and try to look better on your grades, because the upward trajectory is always good for any admissions officer. The other thing I would look to is strengthen your skill. If you are if you're a good wizard, you have an article that is published in the news, some kind of magazine, you know, or you're a science bowl winner or some such thing. Try to play up those strengths of yours. Highlight those qualities about yourself. Go to this side. So how do we get started? And this is just not for anybody with low GPA, this goes for anybody. Try to start making a list of schools. Look into the schools that actually match your GPA, you think you could get in, and more importantly, you think you could go there. There's no point in making a list of schools that you're never going to go. So look into schools that you would want to go, and that matches your GPA. There are a number of such tools out there. Naviance is one of them. Every high school these days uses Naviance. So that pops up a list that could be, you know, more, you know, you get to know where you could, what are your chances of going somewhere. The other one would be, and I cannot stress enough on this, an internship in the interest, you know, of the major that you're interested in. More an industry experience oftentimes, you know, flips the decision for the admissions officer. He knows you are really interested in this school, you have worked in this particular area of major, and you know, you would be an ideal person to fit into their into the school. So these are some things you could consider. Besides this, I would like to see you to think about, once you have hit a slump, try to keep working hard and try to make your GPAs look better. Tutor, whatever it is that is needed, please keep working hard and get those GPAs back up to at least a level where you can fight. There's a fighting chance of getting somewhere you want to go. The other thing I would be is an interesting hobby. If you want to kick it up a notch and try to do well and actually make it, you know, reflect your passion and ability, because that is crucial to everybody. You know, that is immediately seen when they're reading the application. They see that you're really interested in a particular sport or hobby like music or piano or whatever it is. It would help a lot on your, and look good on the application too. Work on getting outstanding recommendation. Just as Namita said, it's very important to get a recommendation letter, because oftentimes they are the people who know you the best. They know how hard you work, how passionate you are, how much of attention to detail you have. So it would be the best thing to, you know, get a wonderful a recommendation letter either from a mentor or a, you know, person you have worked for in the past. They know you the best. And this is one thing I personally feel a lot is working on a compelling personal statement, because it has to come from the heart. And I don't know, it's not a flippant way to say it, but you have to talk about it from whatever comes from, you know, your own words that you put on paper is going to come out well. And it's a story that you get a chance to talk and tell the admissions officer, because nowhere else on the application is he going to know anything else that personal about you. So your essay would be the best place to talk a lot about yourself and describe to them exactly why, what was that obstacle that you overcame, for example, or how did you, you know, deal with a challenge that was thrown at you. So these are some of the things, and there is a college out there for everybody. You really don't need to worry. Talk to your counselors, keep them in the loop, and discuss your low GPAs with them. Discuss, plan of action for that. Do you think you could substitute a class for this, the one that you have currently and you're struggling with? Is there a way you could take another class? So these are some things you should consider. And it was fun chatting with all of you today. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Priya. Thank you all for joining us. Once again, a big round of applause for all our panelists today. Hopefully this is a start. You know, I see some parents here, and some parents have already had kids who have gone to some pretty good schools. Ivy League, I can see one back there who's gone to an Ivy League. She's laughing away. But she's here to soak up more information, because the more knowledge we have, the better it is. I hope so. But what we'll do now is we'll run through a Q&A. I have one question here with me. But before we do that, I would like to invite Karishma Chandani, a word from a sponsor. Coming up. Karishma. Yes. Karishma and Deepak Chandani, and they moved from Los Altos to Saratoga because they enjoy supporting us and me. Thank you.
Thank you. Sorry, I wasn't expecting to be called here, so I'm not prepared. Rishi said there's a very good gathering here. Deepak and I like to support, that's us, and from realtors and developers. We sell real estate, we build homes. And we've supported the school. We support Saratoga High, we support the fundraising causes. And our kids did not go to the Saratoga High School, and they feel that was unfortunate. They wanted to. We just recently moved a couple years ago. They are in college themselves, engineering students. But I'd like to encourage many of you have moved here with intentions to build larger homes. We love to do that. We build custom homes here. Very familiar with the town planning, the city planning, the rules, regulations. We have our own design staff, engineering staff, love to help you build, extend, grow up, grow sideways, any way you want. And of course, if you want to sell your home and, you know, go into a larger home or downsize, we're happy to do that. So, thank you.
Thank you, Karishma and Deepak, for your support. Really appreciate it. And thank you for joining us. So we'll, if you have questions, I have a few questions that we'll run through. If you have questions, firstly, we'll big round of applause for Vidushi right there for volunteering today. Thank you, Namita. You know, we pulled Namita from the audience. She was playing a video game, but now she's got a volunteer hour already piling up, starting today, right? It's a good way to get started. And we have Rishabh. All right, thank you all. And then finally, Ruchika. Ruchika, stand up. because if Ruchika wasn't here, our presentation would not have happened today. So Ruchika and the tiger mom sitting here, Anita. Okay, you can go back to sitting with your mom.
Okay.
Thank you. And so now we'll get through a few questions. Tiffany, would you like to address the audience and say a few words?
Hi, my name is Tiffany. As Rishi mentioned, I am one of the counselors at Bucks College Prep. We are one of the first firms in the Bay Area to do team-style counseling. What we like to do is to make sure students are very aware of the most up-and-coming trends. As you met with Anjali, she is one of our counselors who's had experience working in UC admissions. So each year, we want to make sure that we have the most up-to-date trends with private and public colleges. We at Flex are very concerned not just about college placement, but college readiness, because as most families know, undergraduate is not the terminal degree anymore, and so we want to make sure students are very ready to face any of the academic and personal challenges that they will reach in college. So we also do quite a bit of grad school advising as well. But we mainly see college admissions as more of an outcome of personal growth and study skills, so I'm just wanting to introduce Flex from our team-based model. So I'm happy to be here and be happy to take any questions that might have arisen from Anjali's presentation, as we are quite familiar with both the UC and the private school admissions process. Thank you, Rishi.
Thank you, Tiffany. And so I have a few questions that perhaps I'll give Marci the first chance to answer a question. And yes, if you don't mind passing the mic, that would be great. So there's a question about rigor of course. How important is it to take honors or AP classes in non-major areas? Example, English, history, AP scores 10 majors. So basically, if you're looking at going down engineering, computer science, how important is it to take AP classes for English and history? So in fact, I was just talking to my son about taking APUSH, which is the killer history class in the junior year, and we are kind of debating through it. So thank you, Marci.
It's a great question. There's an honest answer to this, and there's, I don't know, the more kind and gentle answer. So the kind and gentle answer is it's actually not necessary. I have to say it really depends on the level of selectivity of a school that you really are aspiring to. And it comes down to the fact that the top 20 schools, they are essentially kind of cherry picking students out of every high school. So if you're in a high school where most of the students are taking a balance of both humanities and sciences at a high level, and that's helping them achieve a very high GPA, that's the honest engine answer. It's probably the right thing to do if your student can thrive in those classes. However, if not every student can, some students are not as balanced across humanities and sciences, so it would be better not to. And it's okay, and they can showcase their strength in other ways. So it is absolutely not a requirement at all.
Yes, so the addendum to that is basically, in terms of the question was, how many AP classes should we take? 20, 25, 5? What's the right number, magic number? Give us the magic number.
So there is no magic number. There truly is no magic number. Just like I have a lot of families that come in and they have this sort of notion of, I've got to have a sport, I've got to have a musical instrument, I've got to do X hours of community service. It's sort of formulaic in a lot of people's minds. And it actually couldn't be farther from the truth. In fact, the more a student aspires to a higher level school, the more that's actually almost the very wrong path. Colleges are looking for students that are absolutely ignited around something that they really care about or they're fascinated by. And I might go off on a slightly tangent for this question, so I answered it. There's no right answer. But what I would like to say is about extracurriculars for just a moment. And it's really helping your student across the journey of high school start to really get in touch with their strengths, their interests, and help them engage in these things from a young age. And not to worry about, is this exactly the right thing to do at this point in time, but what fascinates them today? dive in. I'm biased toward action. Dive in, get something started, and let them experience it. Let them experience, you know, the fact that maybe a wet lab experience is too painfully slow and methodical. And maybe they're still interested in life sciences, but there's a whole world of global health and policy related to that. So, you know, it allows a student to sort of start to dig in intact as a sailboat their way through extracurricular. I thought I might give you an example since I didn't give a speech, so sorry. I didn't have anyone to help me. I have many examples, but I thought this one might be helpful to you. I'm working with a student this year who I really admire, and her journey through her extracurricular life across high school is inspiring to me. So she's interested in becoming a doctor, life sciences, that world. When she was in a freshman year, she started doing volunteer work at a homeless shelter in the area. And she sort of dug in and became close to the doctor that ran it, and soon realized how short-staffed they were. So she actually decided to sort of lean into this and make it a nonprofit where she would actually build a core of other students, other, you know, people to do volunteer work at the shelter. In the meantime, she's very smart. She's very fascinated by the whole topic of homeless people who go through major operations. And unlike you and I, you know, we go home to our beds, they go back out to the streets. I don't know if you've ever really thought about it. It's shocking. So we live in one of the most prosperous areas in the country, but we are actually the fifth largest homeless center in the country. So she became very intellectually engaged in this whole topic. So she started the nonprofit. She's helping out with good service work there. But on top of it, she's digging in intellectually. So she did a very large study about this whole situation across the United States. And she is not at all an art student, but she ended up doing a documentary where she interviewed people in the public health system, academics, doctors that, you know, are in these systems, and even the homeless people themselves, and really created something that was very awareness building around the needs these people have, but also the journey to homelessness. A lot of these people are very disenfranchised. So I'm sorry, I'm getting long-winded, but the point is, can you see this? Can you see how large this became for her? I mean, she's not only engaged in community service, but it's a very deep intellectual activity. So what I say to you about sort of the extracurricular side is to let it bloom. Get your child involved in very deep experiences, and if possible, have them do a unique self-initiative, something that shows they've got absolutely an inner fire, and they can see a need in the world, in their community, and make something happen around it on their own. There is nothing more powerful than doing something on your own to serve a need in the world. That is the ultimate capability. Sorry.
Thank you, Marci. And the next question I have is for Namita. So I'll give a quick backdrop to this question. You know, back in 2014, there was a proposal in California by one of the senators, which was state constitutional amendment 5. And it was seeking to bring affirmative action back to the UCs in terms of creating a quota system in terms of how we were distributing applicants into the UCs based upon the racial demographics of California. So there was a hue and cry on that, especially from the Asian parents. And Cupertino has a huge Asian population, and the Tiger Moms were in full force basically expressing their viewpoint on that. And I feel it's not fair. It's really not fair, because you're taking a route away from a system of meritocracy versus based upon the racial distribution of California. You know, you can talk about the pros and cons on either side, but obviously it was affecting a segment of the community, and this may not go away, it may come back for us. But the question is basically tied into that. So the question is really, which universities besides the UCs are purely merit-based? So are the universities merit-based today? Where our kids would not be at a disadvantage due to their race or economic status? Please name a few. It's very specific. And versus Harvard, Stanford, kind of student body at 20% Asian, UC Berkeley is 45%. So there are some stats that have been supplied. And I'm going to turn this over to Namita to answer.
So I'll repeat. The question is, which universities, can I see the, it's a long question. Well, it's hard to mention just one or two university at the top of my head, but almost every university, they want to have a diversity. And if you go to universities outside California, out of state, go to East Coast, there are a lot of them, they would welcome you. They want to increase the diversity, so they, your students will not be at a disadvantage. In fact, they will be welcome and you'll get advantage points if you are going to Midwest, going to East Coast. In California, the problem is, or not the problem, just because it's so great that all of us and our kids want to stay in California. And also, all of the students from all of the states, they want to come to sunny California. They want to enjoy the good weather. They want to enjoy the good public university system. So there's a lot of competition going on over their selves. So if you go to like University of Washington in Seattle, there is no disadvantage for you to be because of your race. That's how I it is in a nutshell.
Thank you, Namita. Now I have a question for Priya. It's about transferring from a local community college system to UC. I think Priya touched upon it during her presentation, so I'd love to elaborate a little bit on that.
You can transfer out provided you keep your GPAs at a certain level. So if you are enrolled at Yanza, you took all the right courses, at the end of the year your GPA is at a certain number, you could transfer out to either, you know, any of the UCs that you, at least four that you would pick, and you stand a good chance of getting into. It will also depend on the choice of your major and whether it is impacted at that particular UC. So I would think there's a good chance, you know, that you could transfer out and be successful at a UC.
Thank you. I'm going to turn this over to Ken. And the question is about sports. My son travels most of the summer for his sports. What can a student athlete do to incorporate academic programs and internships into their summer schedule? So how do you do a balance?
It's
a very good question.
And it is a challenge. If your student is a baseball player, they are doing showcases. If your student is a swimmer, they're swimming all over the United States if they're at that national kind of ranked level. So what I have my students do is volunteering. And the volunteering doesn't need to be 8 hours a day, 5 days a week. It may be a morning, a Wednesday morning on one week, and a Thursday morning on another, and we spin that into what they have done. So we're more specific about what they have done about rather than giving it a title. So as I said, I have a preponderance of student athletes, everything from heptathletes, I know, what's a heptathlete, to ice dancers. And it really is about what can we squeeze in to that very limited time frame that these highly accomplished athletes have, and you can. It just, you need to be a little clever, and you have to be willing to go beyond the comfortable. So you're not going to apply for Cosmos for 4 weeks when they aren't going to be here for 4 weeks. So that's kind of where we are.
Thank you.
Tiffany?
And so this is about, Anjali talked about GPA stats, and the question is, it's simple, but it's very important. So are GPA stats weighted or unweighted? And I guess specifically with respect to UC, because Anjali talked about the UCs. But you may want to address all the other colleges as well.
Okay. So GPA, what does it mean? That's probably the number one question I get in the number of families that we meet each week. And I think a lot of times families don't quite like the answer because everybody tends to think of GPA as more of just numbers, right? So one of the top questions we get is, my GPA is 3.67. If I go and take this community college, I've calculated it so that my GPA will go up 0.02. Is it worth taking, right? So a lot of these kind of quantifiable type of questions keep coming up. And that's the exact opposite of how UCs are viewing GPA these days. Especially the selective ones, let's say from Irvine, Davis, LA Berkeley, San Diego. from 2012, they moved away from the admissions point system. Right before, you could get a certain number of points for a certain number of GPA or a certain SAT, ACT score, to a holistic read of your application, which means they read your whole transcript, right? They get a feel for who you are, who is the person behind the grades, who is the person behind the classes, what kind of choices have they made in course rigor. They take a look at your extracurricular activities, what does it kind of say about you, quite a bit on your essays, how do you present yourself. They read everything there to get a feel, and then score you 1 through 5. So the value of GPA has to be in conjunction with all the other pieces to understand who you are. So all that to say, we recommend that students understand that, as Marci was saying, colleges are cherry-picking students from each school, right? They can't take all 200 students from Saratoga who are eligible, who can hang with the UC coursework at, say, UC Berkeley. They can only take a certain number each year, right? So you always need to be aware of where your other classmates are. If the average number of AP or honors classes is about 4 or 5 for a junior, if you want to be competitive within that level of school, you need to be around that average as well, right? So generally speaking, Saratoga High School students are around 4 to 5 APs or honors levels classes per year. And so that's how we're encouraging families to understand GPA as a holistic piece to your application, not just let me calculate what my exact GPA would be. College admissions officers tell us that the GPA is really more for statistical accounting purposes when they finish the read of the application. Right, they're trying to figure out, okay, what's the average GPA of people who are accepted, who weren't accepted, but when they're making the decision of whether or not you get into the school, it's part of the holistic read of how you feel as a student.
So Tiffany, as a add-on to that, when you look at applying to private colleges and the UCs,
sure.
So for example, the private colleges, do they give a little bit more weightage to your activities? Let's say you're a national level soccer player, do you have better chance of getting into the private colleges and universities in comparison to UCs because perhaps your GPA is short? Would you like to address that?
Sure. Just to give you an insider's look as to how the admissions committee processes an application, most selective colleges have 3 main categories of reviewing a student, right? UCs generally just have 1, and their holistic admissions process read everything scale from 1 to 5.
Okay.
But selective colleges like Stanford, right, they have 3 scales. They have the academic scale, score you from 1 to 5, the extracurricular scale, score you from 1 to 5, and then a personal statement scale, because essays are extremely important to Stanford, and a number of selective other colleges like Chicago will also give a separate scale for essay. So Stanford, from year to year and from region to region, they'll place a certain amount of weight for each piece, depending on the region. If you're international, it's a little bit different. They usually say, if you're, let's say, from 1 to 5, 5 being the highest, like AP scoring, right? The highest grade you can get is a 5. A student cannot have lower than a 4 or 5 on the academic, cannot have lower than a 4 or 5 on the extracurricular, and a 4 or 5 on the essay to get in. Okay, so each year, depending on the type of students they're trying to build in their community, remember, they're trying to build a community here, right? They don't want too many students of the same type, right? They may alter the scales accordingly to, you know, maybe they're missing a tuba player this year. And they're trying to figure out, oh, so you're a tuba player and you have very strong academics, okay? You're gonna be a little bit more valuable because that's what our community needs, right? There's a lot of factors in play here. So overall, we encourage families to really try to understand who they are. Students help, have families help students understand who they are, what kind of value can they bring to the community, both as an academic potential scholar and also somebody who can contribute to the next college community in an extracurricular way.
Okay. So next question for Karen, and perhaps you touched upon it, but so this is the, you know, tussle between academics versus extracurricular activities. So you hit your sophomore year, junior year, and you're really, you know, it's your passion. It's what your child wants to do. And at some point, you're looking at how it's affecting the GPA. So at what point do you pull back on something, or do you say, it's okay, absolutely okay? So I don't know if you addressed that in the previous answer, but.
I probably didn't. It depends on the level of competitive athlete. So if we're talking about athletes, if you have a student who is nationally ranked and they don't have a 4.0, that's going to, and I always talk about it as there is a difference between, in some schools, we'll talk about the Ivies, Harvard, Yale, Princeton, does not give additional support to athlete versus student. The other Ivies do. So athlete versus student, if you have a kid who's a 395, a nationally ranked athlete, it opens doors. And that's what I say about many of the activities. If you have a student who is really a superior student, much like all of the colleges say, if you want to submit a portfolio, art portfolio, dance portfolio, writing portfolio, please make sure you are extraordinary. So if you are extraordinary, I think we're talking about something very different. But if you see a student who's a good athlete, but it's not going to open any doors, then I tend to work with parents, and I'm sure we all do, that say, you can't let the academics slip because soccer is fun. So I met with a parent this morning and said, we need to push a little harder on the grades. And do I want to say that the student needs to drop the activity? No, but I think the student needs to know consequences of actions. And then doors start to close.
Excellent, excellent answer. And to summarize, you know, if your child is a star national player, you know, let them pursue it. But if not, then the parents need to do some intervention and tell them, hey, you know, you got to focus on your academics. And if they don't, then point them to a college counselor. Yes. The next question is for Marci. Marci, have you heard of this turning the tide? Have you heard of that? Turning the tide. Turning the tide.
That's the article.
Yes, exactly. So if at all, will turning the tide affect college applicants in the next couple of years?
To be honest, I don't know.
And you may want to give a little background to the context for this article. You know, I myself have not read the article.
Oh, so the article is really talking about trying to help families and also in order to help families incorporating into the decision-making process for admissions, truly a kinder, more holistic review of an individual's character, integrity, involvement with the community, and not so much. I mean, a lot of families are kind of, oh, you know, my child has to compete and win and, you know, be perfect in all these ways. And what happens is you've got a lot of pressure around performance as opposed to developing a wonderful human being and somebody who really has great self-knowledge and is leaning into something that they really care about. So this is all very new. I'm actually going to be very curious to see how it unfolds myself. So I really can't answer that. Can anyone else have any insider knowledge here?
Yeah, so we've noticed that in the past couple of years, many schools have moved to test optional policies as a way to get away from the test crazy that happens with college admissions. And so one of the main points of the article is that colleges are concerned that they have these students that make terrible roommates. They just sit in their rooms and study all the time, right? And so it's a question of how can we find the students who really care about their communities and are doing things because they really care, not because they're trying to fill out an application, right? So in the future, we'll see some schools who are really concerned about the makeup of their community focus a lot more on impact extracurricular activities. Not, I built 800 hours at Good Sam Hospital working in the gift shop, right? That's not volunteer or community impact, but what have you actually done and what kind of legacy have you left in your community? So there'll be more of an emphasis on true extracurricular profiling, and you'll see more and more schools move to test optional and less emphasis on a standardized testing.
That's a good point, Tiffany. So we'll run through three more questions. We'll start with Marci. Marci. And the question is, so with so little information and test history about the new SAT, is there a compelling reason to take it over the ACT? What's yours?
Yes, possibly. So how many people are fairly familiar with the new SAT versus the ACT? Okay, I'm just going to sort of do this in a nutshell, but the old ACT is over, so it's off the plate now, so I don't have to talk about that. But the new SAT is actually oriented a little bit more for a student that's stronger in critical thinking. The critical reading section is one where you're reading passages, very dense amount of information, quickly having to answer nuanced questions about what you just read. But now with the new SAT, in addition, having to identify the text, that's the evidence of why you made the choice you made in answering the question. So good readers will tend to do better in that section. The math part of the new SAT has been actually made to be more problem set oriented and less kind of critical reasoning oriented, which it was in the past. So it's a little bit the difference between a problem like, I apologize because that's the old test. Anyway, it's more similar to the ACT. So the SAT has vocabulary on it. So if your student is a little stronger in that critical reasoning side, it might be their better test. The ACT is a little more time pressured. It has no vocabulary. It does have a science section, so if your child is more oriented toward that, it might be to their benefit. That science section is not chem formulas, it's actually data analysis. So a lot of XY chart reading, what's going on there. Also, if your student is not really going after a very selective school, the ACT can also be a path to not having your child take SAT subject tests. So a lot of lower level colleges or medium level colleges will only ask for the ACT and not two additional SAT subject tests. So it's sort of something to keep in mind.
So we'll take two more questions with Namita and then Priya. And then we'll go back this way with a final wrap up, final words of advice. Okay, so the question for Namita was, I think this is with respect to perhaps private colleges. What role do alumni play in the interview process and the admission process?
Well, again, as Marci said, in selective colleges, everything matters. And the alumni interviews are important because somebody is talking to you as a person, is analyzing and giving an opinion about you, and is taking notes, and these notes are sent back to the admission officer. I have to insist and emphasize that alumni interview will not get you in a certain college, but it can get you out. Meaning, you had a good chance, but you mess up your interview, you will not get in. But at the same time, you don't have a stellar record, and in the selective college, even though you talk very well in your interview, it will not get you in. So it is important.
And one more question, basically. Who reads and evaluates the essays for the students?
The essay is done by the admission officers who reads the whole application as a whole package, and the essay and grade sheet. And as Tiffany mentioned, that every school, every college has their own way of reading and how different rubrics, and they kind of give it a summary. And when after the tying back to the alumni interview, and when the interviewer sends a feedback, then it goes back and goes as a whole file.
Okay, yes. And Priya, so essentially the question is about how do you narrow out your choices. So how do you evaluate your chance probability for a college or to get into a specific college of your interest? So how do you
make a list? That's the question that I would think first is your fit, whether you really like a small college, a big college, what type of setting do you prefer actually? Are you a loner? Would you like to study with a bigger group of kids? It's all about your personal taste. And of course, then you need to match up your GPA, SAT scores, and the other things to what the colleges require. So once you have that, Naviance helps you a lot with that. So it pops up the list of schools that are most suited for you. And then it only becomes, how far do you want to be from home? Most kids say, I want to get out of here. I don't want to stay close to anywhere, close to my parents. So that's one of the topmost reasons why I want to go somewhere. So depending on that, you have different schools that you pick. And of course, keep the list small, maybe 10 schools. I cannot stop stressing enough. Keep it down to at least 10, because the number of essays and supplemental essays that you need to write will just keep spiraling. With the more colleges you have, the more of all that you have to do. So think about all this when you make that list.
So the question to that is, how important is to rely upon the high school counselor when they are making a list?
Very much. I would think she's your confidant, or he or she is your confidant at school. Please talk to them whenever you can. Try to ask them all the right questions regarding, your doubts, fears, worries, because that's your first step
of, you know, help that you would get. Next would be, and I'm sure all of us Asian parents hire an independent counselor, so or maybe not one, maybe two. So then you need to go and ask them that question also. And just to be safe, ask anybody else to, you know, what are my chances? So that's what I can say.
Okay, excellent. So that wraps our Q&A. Any final top of the question that you have in mind, anything at all? Okay, so we'll run through, we are, you know, final 10, 15 minutes, so we'll start, do the final pitch. Anything, final words of advice, anything at all, and if you have a business card, you would like to leave it outside, please feel free to do so.
I would just like to stress on, you know, it's become, you know, parents and students get themselves into this dizzy that, you know, I have to do all of this, starting from junior year onwards, I need to do this. But it's not all that fearful. Once you approach the problem, one step at a time, and are organized, methodical about the whole process. Keep your options open, look for out-of-state schools, be open to going to some place where you haven't been, go and visit the schools. I cannot stress enough on this. Go and see the school actually. Is that a place you'd like to hang out? Is the quad really as good as some one of my friends said it was? Is the canteen a good place to hang out? So these are things I would stress. And definitely make a visit to the school where you really want to go, and please apply to the school that you really want to go. No schools that, you know, it's just there because my friend wanted to go there. That's it.
I'm going to ask you a question, final question. What are the benefits of early application, early decision versus regular? So you want to talk a little bit about that?
Early applications are these days being misused by everybody. It used to be one of those methods where you really wanted to go to a school and you picked the early decision or early action. And there's a difference in each of them. I don't have time to elaborate on that. But I would think if you really wanted to go to a particular school, do early action, because that's when your application is read earlier and you're on top of their list then. Regular action, if your GPS, you're struggling with your GPS, stick to the regular application. Thank you.
As a final advice for overall, I would say please do not stress. It is just a journey of your the whole high school year. Do not, as all of us have said, do not do something just for doing it. Do it if you enjoy it. So, and as for the recommendation letter, it's never too late. And all the people who are freshmen, sophomore, make connections because you might need them later on to write a good letter for you. And in the class, as you said, like, you know, okay, when you're making, and another advice, and a lot of students I have advice is doing is when you're taking your classes in sophomore and junior year, maybe you start writing a journal and write details about the class, what you like, what you do not like, how you excel, and whatever you do, in writing more detail, so that when you are in the senior year, you can go back to your notes and refer and use some of those specifics.
So I just have one word to leave you with, and that's oxygen. And my point is that when you're thinking of picking an activity across high school, or you're actually picking a college, think about something that oxygenates your mind. I couldn't be more enthusiastic around sort of students picking a college that will expand their fearlessness, their sense of confidence, their capacity to do something amazing in the world. It's not about the sun. It's not about where your friends go. It's really, really paying deep attention to what you want to cultivate inside yourself and who you really want to become in the world.
When kids and parents come into my office, which is really kind of a glorified closet, I explain that there are three signs that are virtual. They can't see them. And the first says believe, and the second says apply broadly, which means safe schools, reach schools, and target schools. And the third says be a star. And I don't care where kids go, as long as they are in a place, much like all these other ladies have said, where they can succeed beyond their own expectations. Be a star.
I think just to follow up with that, one of the first questions I ask when students come and meet with us at Flex is, how many hours of sleep are you getting at night? And I'm often very shocked by the averages that we see. It's about 4 or 5 hours. And I want to make sure that students understand that it's a marathon, and we have a number of months left, sometimes years, before we're done. And so we're very encouraging and trying to help students understand that how successful you are when it comes to college admissions or just life in general has a lot to do with time management. You have the psych skills, you have the self-awareness to know where you're at, what your limitations are, and how you can keep moving and improving. And so that's one thing I would encourage students to consider. Try to aim for 7 hours a night if you can, and manage your time well.
Okay, so final words of advice: sleep well, breathe easy, and relax, and everything all falls into place. So with that, a big round of applause for our panelists for taking the time. So you're welcome to meet with them now, collect business cards, whatever else you want. Sandhya, would you like to give out your email address to folks today?
No, we have a card.
You have everything, okay. So we are good. And anything else? We'll be uploading the slide deck into SlideShare. We'll send out a link. And also the video from today will all be uploaded. And as long as you have filled out the sign-up sheet, we get the information. Any other final words of advice for me? No. Thank you all for joining. Thank you. Help out with the chair, we would really appreciate that. Finding the chair, that would be very, very helpful.